Hi guys, it's Dr. Pam and I'm here with this week's burning question. So you're in the doctor's office and your veterinarian has just told you that your dog or cat has a disease state. And you're sitting there in shell shock. While your dog or cat has been slowing down a little bit, maybe not jumping the way he or she should, maybe the coat isn't as lush and lustrous as it used to be, you thought that was aging. You had no idea there was a disease process that was occurring, that was developing. And your vet's talking to you and you're hearing every four words because in your head, you're creating this massive story about what am I gonna do? How am I gonna do this? I don't know what to do. And while that is going on, I'm gonna tell you one thing, stop it. Now I say that because you really do need to stop it because emotion doesn't really get you anywhere. It feels good at the time, but it doesn't get you the results that you want. But the second thing is there's a great video that's on YouTube of Bob Newhart. And Bob Newhart is doing a skit and it's called the Stop It video. You have to download it. In fact, I'll put it in the comment section. This particular video, when I'm having moments where I'm spooling up and I'm feeling a little bit out of control, I pull out my phone and I watch it. Because one, it's a pattern interrupt. It interrupts your neurology. Because when you start to panic, it's like a blooming flower. It keeps going. So you need to stop that. And the only way to actually make a plan of action and figure out what to do is to be in a state of logic, not emotion. So I'm not being critical. I'm there too. And this is what I do to take care of that. And then the second thing that you have to understand is that your vet's going to actually recommend a prescription diet. You know that. In fact, he may have already done that. And you've been listening and you know that prescription diets don't use any different ingredients than Beneful or Old Roy. You also know that they're filled, all the processed pet food ingredients are filled with mycotoxins, drug residues, contamination, and all the things that we fear. You know that they're made with foods not fit for human consumption and that they're not going to provide any nutrient value. So what do you do? Well, this is what you do. Number one, you stop it, that we talked about, until you take a deep breath and you think, what do I know causes every single disease? What do I know? Inflammation and nutrient deficiency. Those two things always are at the base of every single disease process. Okay, so nutrient deficiency, we need to work on a diet. Now, you know I'm gonna say whole food diet because I believe in that, and there's a lot of research to support that, and we'll talk about more of that next week. The interesting thing is the format of the food that you give matters because there's different types of whole food diets on the market right now. You've got your raw food, you've got your cooked foods, which you can make at home, but you can also purchase them. You've also got air-dried, freeze-dried, and some of the dehydrated are really good as well. How do you know which one fits? So I'm going to tell you straight up, I always start every single case the same. I use cooked food. Why? I thought you said raw food was the most nutrient dense. It is. But in a disease state, your digestion is downregulated and you don't have the biochemistry that you do in a healthy state. And raw food absolutely requires a healthy biochemistry to extract it. Otherwise, then it just moving through the intestine and you're not getting any benefit from it. In fact, it creates some levels of reaction if that happens in a disease state. So by starting with cooked food, it does decrease the nutrient density, but it makes it in a format that the body can actually assimilate and use. And why is that important? It is potently anti-inflammatory. So this week, I introduced the case of Wolf. Wolf was one of my more complex cases. He had 7 different diseases and 20 different medications that were human medications being used off-label. He was referred to me by an internist. He was a hot mess, and he had 3 foot in the grave and 1 foot on the banana peel. So how did I start his case? I put him on a cooked food diet because we needed a potent, rapid decrease in inflammation. Rapid, okay? His liver enzymes were at 10,000. We dropped him in 2 weeks to down below 2,000, and by 4 weeks, his liver enzymes were normal. That's how rapid it is, okay? And that's only one disease process. I'm not even talking about the other 6. So what we're going to do on the email list is we're going to break it down. We're going to take Wolf's case, and we're going to break it down, and we're going to talk about each disease process because he pretty much had all of them. And and teach you how to target a diet to work with that disease process. So if you're not on my email list, I would sign up. The second thing that I'm going to tell you is not only is the food going to be potently anti-inflammatory, but a Rimadyl and or a, I don't know, a Galliprant or a Prevacox, that's not going to cut it. We're talking about visceral inflammation. So you need to move to another type of anti-inflammatory action. What does that? The holistic modalities that we've talked about, acupuncture is a big one, but PIMF technology using an assisi loop and such is super important in these cases because it's not adding another thing into the regimen. And when you have that number of drugs, you have to worry about interaction. That's why we don't throw herbs at every case initially, because you have herb-to-drug interactions. You have drug-to-drug interactions, but you also have herb-to-drug interactions, and you have to know about those as a practitioner so you don't create more harm, okay? Now, there's been a comment made by Cheryl about her dog Tova, who, as she's aged on a whole food diet, has dementia, is developing dementia. So here's one of the things I want to tell you guys. It goes back to the same thing. Boom. Anti-inflammation, or inflammation causes more problems, and nutrient density. So when I see a dog that starts developing dementia, I think of a couple of things. Number one, I always think adrenals because they're burning out in an aging dog. Number two, I'm thinking, where are the kidneys? Are the kidneys kind of having some problems because the adrenals and the kidneys are aligned? And then I think, okay, inflammation. And Tova has neuroinflammation, because when you start developing inflammation in your body, it's going to go wherever it can. And in her state, it's going neuroinflammation. So it goes back to gut again, because remember that there were four things that led into inflammation, and the top two are adrenals and the gut. And there you have it right there for her. So I would adjust her homemade diet to make it more anti-inflammatory using more anti-inflammatory foods. And then the second thing that I would do is add some adrenal support onto that product, onto that that protocol. And then thirdly, I would make sure the kidneys are supported and such like that. And that inflammatory aspect, what can you do where you don't have to add another pill or another powder or another blah, blah, blah? Food and a assisi loop. That little girl's this big, so you could use one loop and get the whole dog, or you can do a loop lounge. I love that that loop pad, okay? You could use that in Tova very, very easily. And any other dog. Now, I know Tova very well. So these are things that you can use in dementia cases. Assisi loops are great. Using whole foods that are anti-inflammatory are great ways to help combat that. But always watch your kidneys and make sure you support the adrenals as well. I hope that helps, Cheryl. And everybody else, we're going to continue the discussion on email. Take care and have a great day.